Welcome to ESPN2's second round coverage of the MasterCard NIT. Tonight, we're in Tempe, Arizona, as the Arizona State Sun Devils play host to the Southern Illinois Salukis. Check the NIT bracket. The winner of this game moves on to play the winner of Creighton and Florida. They will tip it off tomorrow night, 9:30 Eastern Time over on ESPNU. Syracuse, the lone team to have clinched a spot in the quarterfinals. They beat Maryland earlier today. And hi, everybody. Scott Reese alongside Mike Kelly. This, the 18th and final men's college basketball game of the day. Of course, 16 of those in the NCAA tournament. If you're still watching, it means you can't get enough hoops. And I tell you, Mike, these two teams can't get enough hoops. They want to keep on playing.
Absolutely. You know, the first round is behind them. I think the NIT, the first round is definitely the hardest. You've got teams like Arizona State and Southern Illinois, both thought they should be in the NCAA tournament, wanted to be in the NCAA tournament, and they didn't get there. So they have to get past the first round. But now they're starting to think, you know, we could get to New York. We could get a championship after all.
And, of course, you want star power. We've got it in the form of one of the best freshmen in all the land, James Harden of Arizona State.
James Harden is sensational. He can score in so many different ways. You see him in transition at first. He's very quick up the floor, off the rebound, and then he's got the great outside shot. And what that does is open up the defense on the inside so he can put the ball on the floor, penetrate on the inside, and get all the way to the rim. And then we take a look at the star watch. Harden, of course, great in his first game, and Randall Falker for Southern Illinois. It'll be very important for Falker to get some points inside and also move Jeff Pendergraf, the big guy for Arizona State.
Saluki's going to need offense from Falker, a shorthanded SIU team tonight. We'll talk more about that as we get set to tip it off next from Wells Fargo Arena, Arizona State, Southern Illinois. The Valley of the Sun has given way to the Valley of the Moon. A picture-perfect evening here in the Arizona desert following what was a beautiful 85-degree day. Southern Illinois and Arizona State, second round of the MasterCard NIT as the Sun Devils prepare to defend their home floor after knocking off Alabama State in the first round. Starting lineups first for the visiting Salukis, and you see Matt Shaw and Randall Falker going to be responsible for putting up points tonight in the absence of Bryan Mullins, who was such a consistent force for this team all year as a stress fracture in his left leg. Arizona State starts three freshmen, including the phenom James Harden. We talked about him in the open. Keep your eye on Richard Kuksix. Rehards Kuksix has really come on in the last 10 games for the Sun Devils. Ready for basketball in this second round of the National Invitation Tournament. It'll be Falker and Jeff Pendergraf, and the Salukis control the tip.
Wesley Green is going to handle the point. As you mentioned, Bryan Mullins, I think the heart and soul of this team, out for this game. He did not play in their first round game. He was the defensive player of the year in the Missouri Valley Conference. And it's very difficult to adjust when you have a player, a starting guy, and someone who leads your team out this late. It's hard to find your identity. We'll see if Green can handle the point guard duty.
Matt Shaw underneath, no, but there is Falker with the offensive rebound. And once again, Arizona State controls. So the early interior defense by Jeff Pendergraf, and the Sun Devils will set up the offense. Derek Glasser, who incidentally played high school ball with James Harden, will run the point for ASU. Pendergraf is the cog in the middle that makes things go. Kuksix for three, draws iron, but there's Harden underneath, and he gets stripped of the ball, so defense prevailing on the early going.
Both teams getting after the offensive glass. It'll be important for Southern Illinois, I think in particular, to get after it. Arizona State wanting to play a matchup zone, making it difficult to get on the glass because you don't have a body on a specific man as you would man-to-man.
And there's Falker with position inside, and he scores the first two of the game.
You know, we talked to Chris Lowery, and he said, we have to move Jeff Pendergraf. He's so great inside that if you don't make him guard and make him move side to side, he'll sit in the middle and he'll block everything that goes in there. That time, Falker doing a great job, early position creating the open lane.
Meanwhile, the key for Arizona State defensively is keep the big fella out of foul trouble. He has shown a propensity to pick up some quick, sort of ticky-tack kind of fouls. This is Ty Abbott, another outstanding freshman here. It's picked off and back the other way. A run-out opportunity. Tyrone Green with the throwdown.
Tyrone Green, he's one of these players. He comes in, He's got a great poise on the basketball court. He's not a scorer. He doesn't even shoot from probably outside of 15 feet. The scouting report says you don't have to guard him out there, but I mentioned he'll handle the point guard duties. He can bring the ball up the floor, and he's a great defender. He's a very strong player, and when he gets it in transition, he knows how to finish on the other end.
He picks up the foul on the defensive end. Chris Lowery, the head coach at Southern Illinois, has done just a fantastic job with his team, a consistent postseason performer, really the NCAA tournament the last 6 years, and this year the NIT.
Yeah, former player, great player at Southern Illinois. Yep. The only player to lead a team in the Valley to the tournament as a player and then lead him as a coach.
And only 35 years of age. Wise beyond his years, Coach Lowery. Meanwhile, Arizona State once again runs the offense through Pentagraph. There is Glasser for three, in and out. And back the other way comes Green.
Well, we're seeing Southern Illinois continue to play man-to-man. We talked already about Mullins not being in the game, but Tony Boyle is a guy we're not sure if we're going to see. He's one of their big guys. He rolled his ankle yesterday in practice, and he may not play at all today.
And that makes this a very shallow Southern Illinois team. Guys like Green and Clemens going to play a lot of minutes. Josh Bone as well, as this one is out of bounds off of Harden, so the Sun Devils turn it over. Arizona State coached, of course, by Herb Sendek, who wants an early timeout, not pleased with the 4-0 start. And we'll tell you more about Coach Sendek when we come back. Salukis with the early 4-0 lead. We're right back. Back in Tempe, Arizona, where Southern Illinois leads Arizona State 4-0. You see Herb Sendek, whose teams have averaged 19 victories a year in his career, which began at Miami of Ohio, went through NC State, and now leads him here to Tempe.
You know, I think the issue there, taking an early timeout, is this team right now settling for outside shots. They're not going inside as they should, getting some post touches. And for a team in Southern Illinois that's depleted, playing without Mullins and Boyle, I think you have to try and get them in foul trouble. You have to get the ball inside the Pentagraph and not just worry about the offensive rebounds. You can't settle for those quick outside shots.
Meanwhile, the Salukis work it around the perimeter. This is Josh Bone who knocks down the triple, and it is 7-0. Back the other way quickly. Here is Harden to the rack, and Arizona State is on the board.
You're going to see James Harden do that so much today. I've never seen a guy get out in transition. He's a lefty, but he likes to go in transition on the right-hand side and then cross over to his left hand for either a dunk or a lay-in, and he does it again there. Southern Illinois not getting back quick enough and getting in front.
He might be the best right-handed lefty this side of Michael Beasley. This is Green again running the point in the absence of Bryan Mullins. Matt Shaw, who sometimes is a reluctant shooter, not going to have that luxury tonight. They need his offense. Bone tries his luck again, and once again, the Devils will push. Pendergraph got bumped en route to the basket. The Green is incredulous as he picks up his second quick foul, and that is the last thing that Southern Illinois needs.
Well, that's exactly the foul trouble I'm talking about. You push the ball up the court, you get it inside. That time on the inlet pass, trying to get it to Pendergraph, you're able to pick up two quick fouls. Tyrone Green, a great player, hit that shot early after the steal. He goes all the way for the dunk, and now he's going to have to go to the bench as they bring in Christian Cornelius, a little-used player, but without Tony Boyle, they're running out of options.
Yeah, Cornelius, a guy who's had multiple knee surgeries. He's still not 100%, but you know what? You got to play. This is Abbott. Comes up short, and Falker the rebound.
We've seen Southern Illinois hit some shots early. Very important for this team. They're known as a great defensive team. Everybody calls them floor burn you. They've earned that reputation for how they play defense, but when they hit shots, that's when they could become a really dangerous team.
Well, Pendergraph blocks not once, but twice. Falker going to go at it one more time, and this time there is contact and a whistle. And that brings us to a break in the action. Arizona State on the board, but still SIU with the early 7-2 cushion. Southern Illinois with a 7-2 lead over Arizona State, just over 4 minutes into this second round game in the MasterCard NIT. And Mike, we talk about the walking wounded, or sitting wounded as it were, for the Salukis, beginning with Tony Boyle, who gave him a big lift with 10 points in the Oklahoma State win.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, he's a guy that doesn't score a lot, but he comes off the bench, he plays, and he gets those 10 points against Oklahoma State. Such a big key to that win. They needed him. He turns his ankle, and now they're playing without Bryan Mullins, who was the defensive player of the year in the Missouri Valley. I think he's one of the best defenders in the country. I love his game. And so now you're playing without your best defender, your point guard, and one of your big guys that's just coming off a big game, 10 points. I mean, it doesn't get any harder. Now you got to go on the road and play Arizona State.
Mullins also the leading three-point shooter on this team, but so far, so good for the Salukis. They lead it 7-2 as Harden almost turns it over, but finds the handle. Drive and dish. Shot by Jamaal McMillan, another good-looking freshman, is no good, but the Sun Devils will reset. We'll talk a lot about the freshman power on this Arizona State team. A lot of minutes for first-year players, including that guy, Ty Abbott, who cannot connect. He is 0-2.
This is almost like a futures game for Arizona State. They've got so many freshmen and sophomore out there. Pendergraph, the junior that actually starts for this team, but a lot of talent, a lot of young talent. And after the big turnaround from last year, you can see them continuing to get better.
Oh, and Carlton Fay got fouled on a three-point attempt. So a freshman mistake by a guy who's not a freshman, Eric Boateng, the Duke transfer. And we've got three free throws upcoming.
Yeah, Carlton Fay, the guy that's going to shoot the free throws. He's a big guy, but he's got great touch from the outside. And I saw this team earlier in the year play Indiana. And the story on Fay was his offense was ready, but nobody knew about his defense. Of course, he's playing for Southern Illinois, one of the best defensive teams in the country. So even if you're a good defender as a freshman, you probably come in and have a few things to learn.
Hard to get noticed.
Right, it's hard to get noticed, but he came in. He's really worked very hard this whole season. It's a long season. As a freshman, he's never gone through something like this, a 30-plus game season, the physicality of the college level, but Fay's adjusted pretty well. He's a guy I project to get better and better every year, and I think by the time he's a senior, he'll be an All-Missouri Valley type of player, perhaps the type of player that could be the player of the year and lead Southern Illinois back to one of those championships.
Third free throw is up, bounces around, and no good, so only one of three, failure to capitalize on the three-point foul, and back the other way in an 8-2 game comes Arizona State. McMillan handling the point. In traffic, gets it to Harden. Once again, the drive and dish. This is Jaron Shipp, one of the fabulous Shipp brothers in the Pac-10. Harden is not fouled. We're going to get a jump ball. MasterCard NIT continues on ESPN Saturday as the Akron Zips meet the UMass Minutemen in second-round action. MasterCard NIT second round, ESPN Saturday at noon Eastern.
Akron's going to need another big game from Nick Dials. He had 13 points in overtime in their last game against Florida State, a big win. Three 3-pointers in that overtime period.
And UMass out of that Atlantic 10 conference, which was just so hard to figure throughout the regular season.
I didn't have trouble figuring out. I knew they were good. That's why I told everybody they wanted to know about the A-10. I mean, that was a great conference, and it's a shame. I don't think they got enough credit for all the great teams.
Problem was figuring out who was better than who, because it seemed to flip-flop on a weekly basis.
Ryan Roberts got injured for Dayton. That was something I think hurt, because they were gaining some steam, you know, nationally. People started to recognize Dayton. They had some big wins. They beat Syracuse. And Louisville they beat. And after those big wins, I think people started to take notice. But then Roberts gets hurt, and I think Xavier was probably the only team that anybody paid a whole lot of attention to nationally.
Arizona State back on the offensive, still trailing 8-2. The Sun Devils cold 0-for-6 from beyond the arc. Shipp will give it a try, and now ASU is off the schneid with a big three ball.
What they've started to do well is get the ball inside. I particularly like the way they're dribbling inside for the driving dish. That time, though, a pass into the middle collapsed the defense enough to open up the outside shot.
Falker is swarmed. 3-4 defenders, somehow maintains control, blocked by Boateng. And now we're going to get another jump ball.
You watch Arizona State as they work with the ball. I think they have to get it inside somehow, either with dribble penetration or just finding Harden on the inside, because he demands so much attention. Everybody's going to collapse. Southern Illinois, a great defensive team. Team-wise, they'll come with all that help, but then they can't get out the machines fast enough.
SIU with a possession arrow. There's the soft pull-up from Matt Shaw. He cannot find Bottoms. And back the other way we go. It's McMillan. Three freshmen on the floor for Arizona State. There's one of them, Abbott. This time he takes it to the rack. Dish, the extra pass, and again the extra pass inside, and that's just pretty. Harden finding Abbott.
Yeah, Chris Lowery's going to get a timeout. Right now, Arizona State getting what they want. The last few offensive possessions, they just look faster than Southern Illinois. They're working with the ball. Great ball movement, side top side, getting it inside, making the extra pass. And that's what coaches love to see. I'm sure Herb Sendick pleased as he's talking to his team now. And you watch them work without it. I love the baseline drive. Ohio State was the first team I saw do that really well with Scoonie Penn and Michael Redd. And you see what it leads to. You go baseline, you kick it weak side. Boateng goes to the top of the key. The fake pass by Harden there, the fake shot by Harden for the pass. That's just great ball movement and great teamwork. And that takes guys, we talked about the younger guys in this team. You can do that at the end of the season. These guys know how to play with each other and work off each other.
Well, how about this first team for the Pac-10 this season? And you see freshmen, along with Brook Lopez and Ryan Anderson.
Freshmen.
And Lopez and Anderson are sophomores.
Not so bad. How about James Harden? As great as he is, maybe the third best freshman in the conference?
And you know what? Harden may be the only guy on that panel who's back next season.
I think he will be. We talked to the coaches about that. They think he will be. They've got some great talent coming in next year. I sure hope he does. I really like his game. I think he can improve in some areas by using his right hand a little bit better, maybe getting stronger, better condition. And you know what? All the great players that are going to come out in the NBA this next year, maybe better to stay around, get a higher draft pick.
Abbott thought about working for a better shot, and he figured, hey, I am wide open. But Ty Abbott struggling from the perimeter early on. SIU trying to find an offensive rhythm, which, again, it's hard enough for this team on a day-to-day basis. This is not by any means an explosive offensive ball club. You take away Mullins, you take away Boyle, you throw in a matchup zone that they don't see day in and day out, certainly in the MVC, and they've got their work cut out for them to put points on the board.
You know, I think the issue for Southern Illinois all year long has been scoring. They're a great defensive team. When they hit their shots, it's when they play at their best. When they're making those, you know what you're going to get defensively out of them. So when they hit those shots and when they play at the highest of level, and now when you lose those guys, it makes it that much more difficult. You got to call on a guy like Josh Bone or Wesley Clemens, I think, to start making some of those shots and open some things up. You got to take them and hope that they fall.
Eric Boateng saddled with the foul. He will sit. And the Salukis reset. This is Bone. Get it to Falker inside. And another block by Pantograph. That is his fourth of the day. McMillan will pull it out, find the open man. This is Ship. And they're going to call an offensive foul on Jaron Ship. Matt Shaw had position.
It was a nice skip pass to set this up. And Ship goes baseline after the pump fake. That's just too hard of a closeout by Faye there.
That's close. The fans don't think it was even close.
Do they ever? Well, you know, you mentioned playing against the matchup zone. And Pac-10 teams are used to that only one day of rest, the Thursday, Saturday. And right now, both of these teams, after playing the Tuesday game, only had a day to figure out who they were going to play and what style of play they're going to have to go up against. So it's very difficult. It's one thing to do it in conference when you know the other teams and the programs. It's another thing when you got to go against a new team.
Southern Illinois with a one-point lead. Coming up, you will meet the Falker, as in Randall, the star player for SIU. Get in the game. Randall Falker asserting his presence early, although he's been stymied largely by Jeff Pantograph. 8-7, Southern Illinois leads Arizona State. But Falker, not just a great player, he is an interesting individual as we meet the Falker. And the first thing that jumps out at you is, dude hasn't had a haircut since April of 2004.
Well, that's not fair. I mean, that's the style, right? I mean, you can't hold that against them. I like that. I always wonder, how long does that take? I mean, I'm a Packer fan, so I got all these guys in the Packers now. It's the big thing in the NFL, the Al Harris, you know, to do the long dread. So 2004, okay, now I got a frame of reference.
He's gone 4 years without a haircut.
I like that
you haven't gone 4 weeks.
Right. I like that he designed the media guide. That's pretty good. I don't think they would have given me that option.
Well, he dabbles in graphic art, and I tell you what, he's no dummy. If you're going to design the media guide, who are you going to put front and center, right?
You got to make it bigger, though. Look at this. See, he had to show some love to his teammates so they pass him the ball. That's a good decision there.
Falker, though, just 1 of 7 from the floor, and a big reason for that is the defense of Jeff Pantograph, who has already tied his career high, Mike, with 4 blocks. He's played barely 9 minutes of this ballgame. And there's Ship almost with the interception, but Josh Bone comes away with the basketball.
One of the keys for Southern Illinois was to move Jeff Pendergraft. They wanted him to go side to side, maybe screen him a bit, but Southern Illinois has not been successful at doing that.
Wesley Clemens with the shot clock winding down, and that's a big bucket from him.
It's a big bucket, but it's a tough bucket. I mean, he can hit those shots, but when you get down to the end of the shot clock and you have to take a one or two dribble pull-up over the defender, those are not high percentage shots.
Salukis with a 10-7 lead, but they've struggled for offense in the last 5 minutes. This is Jared Shipp with the open look, and he cannot knock it down. So ASU getting clean looks from beyond the arc, just not able to finish.
Yeah, I think that was the first time we saw some really good Princeton-style movement offensively for Arizona State, getting the ball high post, having the cutter go through the lane, and that sucked two defenders in. And we get the look from the outside, it just didn't fall.
This is Falker again, and this time he wins the battle with Pendergraft. Every time he touches the basketball, he is swarmed. Southern Illinois up by 5. Jamaal McMillan, freshman, running the point for Arizona State. Fellow freshman James Harden and Richard Kuksic on the floor, and we're going to get a foul away from the ball.
See, Randall Falker's the type of guy, he's got to work quick with the basketball. He's not very big, only about 6'7". So when he gets it, the defense can get there. A big guy like Pendergraft can get over the top. He's got to get that ball and work fast. He did a great job on that possession. He's strong, though. You know, he might not be the tallest guy or the biggest guy, but he's very strong. He can work fast. Adding that 15, 18-footer, I think, would be the thing that takes him and allows him to succeed at the next level.
We're going to get a hold on Clemens. His second foul, so a couple of starters now for Southern Illinois, Green and Clemens, both with two fouls, and as we talked about at the top of the broadcast, the last thing this SIU team needs is foul trouble.
They hit it once again. Bryan Mullins, the defensive player of the year in the Valley, not going to play with a stress fracture, did not play the last game. And Tony Boyle, their forward inside, coming off a big game, 10 points against Oklahoma State. He rolled his ankle yesterday.
Here is Harden. Drive, draw, dish, gets it back. So unselfish as he finds Kuksic in the corner, and that is vintage James Harden.
Yeah, you know, almost too unselfish.
Sometimes.
It's a good shot. They get the three, but when you score 18 points a game, I almost think you should take that shot. That's the second time he's passed it up. Both times he got an assist, so you can't blame a kid for being so unselfish when they're getting good buckets. But he's a guy, I think Arizona State needs to score some points. They only got 10 so far. Have struggled a bit. They've gotten good shots, just haven't had them fall.
He averages almost 18 points a game, but unlike some other outstanding freshmen around the nation, doesn't do it taking 20 shots a night. He's very selective. He shoots a high percentage, and it's worked for Arizona State more often than not, but your point is well taken. There are times where a kid with his abilities really has to step up and be the man.
Why are you going to bring up O.J. Mayo?
Did I mention O.J. Mayo specifically?
I'm pretty sure that's who you're talking about. Let's see. A freshman takes about 20 shots a game. I think it's probably O.J. Mayo.
Falker with a rebound, and he walked with it. And Randall pulling on those dreadlocks. I don't think he agreed with that call.
I see Deion Coopwood in the game. A little bit of a press from Southern Illinois. Kind of surprising when you're playing shorthanded. Usually you don't stretch the court on the defensive end.
Coopwood, a former walk-on, senior guard, 5'11", out of Calumet City, Illinois. And again, here's a guy who scores less than half a point per game. The Salukis going deep into the well as they play shorthanded without Mullins and Boyle. Arizona State will inbound. 23 on the shot clock. Kuksic, ball fake. And this is Derek Glasser.
Southern Illinois going 2-3 out of that inbounds play. I think they're going to try and match up man if they can.
This time Harden will take it, and so smooth with that lefty stroke. First three ball of the night for James Harden.
You know, it looked like Deion Coopwood thought they were going to switch up to man-to-man. They were in 2-3. He was on the top of that zone. Harden was his man, but he dropped down thinking they were in man, but they weren't. And so he leaves them wide open, and Harden makes them pay.
First lead of the night for the Sun Devils, and this Tempe crowd has come alive at Wells Fargo Arena. Here's Falker, loses the handle, gets it back one more time. And this time it is Shaw underneath, and there's the fifth block by Pendergraft.
boy, how many looks are they going to get? And ultimately, Arizona State comes away with it. What about the interior defense?
Well, it's surprising because Southern Illinois, not the biggest team down low, with Pendergraph in there, they've got some size on them, but Southern Illinois just more active on the offensive glass.
Harden again, but it will not count as there was a whistle before the shot. That is 7 offensive rebounds already for Southern Illinois, but they haven't been able to convert most of them into points.
Well, you know what? One thing, though, if you're struggling offensively, you're not hitting your shots, at the very least, stay active on the offensive glass. It bodes well for the Salukis, even if you're not hitting your shots, that you can get on the glass.
Well, that one would have counted, but it does not go for Harden. That foul, incidentally, was on Randall Falker, his first.
A breakdown defensively by Cookwood versus Chris Lowery, bringing him out of the game, and put Tyrone Green back in, playing with 2 fouls. Important for him to not pick up a third.
Here is Green back in, playing with 2 fouls, running the point. Carlton Fay. And again, this zone defense seems to be confounding the Salukis, and that's the way to beat it, as Matt Shaw shoots him right out of it.
Shaw is one of these guys that he's a difference maker when he hits his outside shot. He's been hot and cold all year long, probably more cold than hot. But as a big guy, he can stretch the defense. He can come out and make the big guy try and guard him. I talked about that Indiana game earlier in the year. He went like 1 for 9. If he hits a few more of those shots, they beat Indiana at home.
As Abbott misses once again, he can't find the stroke. And you mentioned Shaw stretching the defense, Mike. There aren't a lot of players on the Southern Illinois team who can do that. They are not a good three-point shooting team.
No, but I love Shaw. I love the way he plays. He's got a great stroke from the outside. I almost expected more out of him because I think he's that good of a player. I really love his stroke and the way he can stretch the defense. But when the shots aren't falling, the defense doesn't have to come on.
And that's going to be a travel as Shaw turns it over. Southern Illinois up by 2.
James Harden, the guy, getting it done from the outside with that sweet stroke. And the Arizona State faithful love it.
All right, Kevin, thanks very much. Regional coverage of the NCAA Women's Basketball Championship tips off Saturday on ESPN2, as you'll see either Georgia Tech take on Iowa State or UT San Antonio meet Texas A&M. First round of the NCAA Women's Basketball Championship presented on ESPN by Orbitz. ESPN2 Saturday at noon Eastern Time. Well, Randall Falker and Matt Shaw are a combined 3 of 17 from the floor. Amazing, the Salukis somehow with a 2-point lead.
Well, Falker with 6 offensive rebounds. We've talked about him a few times on the glass. Important for him to stay after it. They haven't been able to convert many of those. Not a lot of second chance points, but at least they're getting at it, getting after it offensively. You know, going after, giving them some chances, which is probably the biggest thing, because eventually when you get those offensive rebounds, you're close to the basket, you put them back in.
Exactly. Plenty of second chances. It's just the points part of the equation that hasn't come through. Here's Harden. Sees out of the double team. Jaron Schipp from the corner, and that is big. Schipp hits his 2nd triple of the day. Arizona State now just 4 of 14 beyond the arc. And this was an ASU team, Mike, that in the win over Alabama State 2 nights ago relied heavily on the 3-point basket.
And some of the best looks they're getting are when they get the ball into the high post first and then pass it out of the high post. It's collapsing the defense from Southern Illinois. A great help defensive team, but they're not able to recover outside to the 3-point shooter.
Sun Devils lead at 16-15 as we approach 5.5 minutes to go in this first half of play. They get it inside to Falker over the double team. He misses again, and this time there will be no second chance. This time we have got a foul on Carlton Fay.
You watch Arizona State. I mentioned when they're shooting well, when they're getting good shots, they're getting in the high post first. James Harden, such a great passer out of the high post, and he's able to get it over. The nice tip pass to get it to Schipp in the corner to bury the outside shot. And you've got a guy like Harden with so much poise as a freshman to go in that high post spot. You know, a lot of guys talk about getting there to break down the defense. It's one thing to get there, but when you get it and the defense collapsed, to have the presence of mind to then pass it out to the right guy and get the shot is another thing. And James Harden is one of those special players that has that ability.
Here is Abbott, who is 0 for 5, make it 1 for 6 from beyond the arc. And all of a sudden, the shots are starting to fall for the Sun Devils.
Well, you know what's killing Chris Lowery right now is they have to play zone because they're shorthanded. They don't have their full roster with Mullins and Boyle on the bench. This team never plays zone. They're always a man-to-man team. Right now, they have to go 2-3 or 3-2, and they're giving up the outside shots.
Falker might have walked with it, and he did. So turn it over back to Arizona State and the Sun Devil faithful on their feet here at Wells Fargo Arena.
You know, Arizona State used to play in the matchup zone. Herb Senek went to it last year because they were shorthanded as well. They just didn't have the bodies to go out there and play man-to-man in a full Pac-10 18-game schedule. So he goes matchup zone, and he found out, hey, you're pretty good at this, so you continue to play it. And it's one thing for a team. If you know you're going to play zone, you can get good at it. But when Southern Illinois, a traditionally man-to-man team, tries to play zone, you're just not going to be as good. You can try, but it's not the same. And right now we're seeing a man-to-man team in Southern Illinois try and play zone, and they're struggling to find the outside shooters.
So what you're saying is you can't teach an old Saluki new tricks?
I suppose you could put it that way, absolutely. But, you know, Chris Lowery, I just empathize with the guy on the sideline. He's got a team right now at the end of the year trying to make a run in the NIT tournament. When you're trying to do it without your starting point guard and one of your forwards that's coming off a good game, it's very difficult. You don't have a lot of hot.
Scott Reese, Mike Kelly with you. Courtside at Wells Fargo Arena, Arizona State 19, Southern Illinois 15. Second round of the MasterCard NIT. And another scoring drought for the Salukis now, going on more than 3 minutes without a point. This is Green, drive and dish. Clemens for three, got it. And again, a big bucket from Wesley Clemens, who has given them just enough offense to stay in this thing. Back the other way. Kuksic puts it on the floor. And the Sun Devils will reset.
See, Southern Illinois, I talked about all that zone. I think Chris Lowery had enough. They go back man-to-man.
Back to your bread and butter. And this is the bread and butter of Arizona State as Jeff Pendergraft scores inside.
You know, you can see why people project him into the NBA. Because it's a two-man game right there. He goes up, sets the high ball screen, and then flashes down low to the post. That's pretty much everything the NBA does, and he does it very well.
Shaw off the screen, can't get it to go, and this is Harden starting the pseudo-break. There is Pendergraft out in front, and he finishes once again. And we're going to get a timeout by Chris Lowery in Southern Illinois.
How about that? Talk about the two-man game, and then he gets out of transition. Those NBA scouts will like that. Just the junior, Jeff Pendergraft, knowing how to work the screen and roll as Falker, his man, goes to trap. Shaw comes over, but Shaw doesn't have the height to be able to compete with him on the down low. And how about Harden getting that rebound, passing it out, and Jeff Pendergraft to get out in front of the other big man is so important. He's able to do it, and he's pumped up. I talked about, you know, the first round game is so difficult. That team, Arizona State, thought they should be in. Oregon's playing in the tournament. They're a 9 seed. They think they're just as good as Oregon. They beat them once this year. Arizona's in a 10 seed. They lose today by 10 points. Arizona State probably thinking, hey, we could have done that. Put us in. We could have lost by 10.
Arizona State swept its arch rival from Tucson during the regular season. As you look at the MasterCard NIT bracket, the winner of this game will get either Creighton or Florida. Syracuse has already moved on to the quarterfinals. See what Chris Lowery comes up with out of the timeout as we're approaching 3 minutes to go in the half. And another turnover. I don't think that's what Coach Lowery drew up.
Tyrone Green with nowhere to go, trying to go baseline.
Arizona State beginning to assume control. A five-point lead over the Salukis. All right, Kev, we look forward to that. Our score here is 23-18. Arizona State, after a sluggish start, has come on in about the last 6 or 7 minutes, and it's been Jeff Pendergraft and James Harden keying the run.
Well, James Harden, the leading scorer for Arizona State, obviously he's got to get his shots, but what he's been great at so far today is finding the open man. We've seen him work at the high post, and that collapses the defense. It makes them turn their head, and then he finds the open man. Great at putting the ball on the ground. A couple times we've seen him go up for the shot and then actually not shoot it, but pass it. And then once you do that, loosen up the defense a bit, get a little one-on-one, able to create for himself. James Harden, one of those players, he's got great poise on the basketball court, great presence of mind, the ability to know when he's got to get his own shot, when he's got to find shots for his teammates. 4 assists, 5 rebounds on the day.
He is a complete basketball player, and here he is splitting the double team and scoring. And again, you watch a play like that and you wonder, why doesn't he shoot the ball more?
Well, he shoots enough. I mean, he's scoring 18 points a game this year. And you watch him work from the right side, he's more comfortable there. He likes to get the right-hand side, and he can use his left hand to dribble into the lane.
Arizona State up by 7, largest lead of the game for the Devils. They try to work it inside to Shaw, who will back it out again. Josh Bone rise and fire, and that again, a big three-point bucket. So whenever it seems like ASU is going to run away with it, Southern Illinois manages to find a three-point basket. McMillan looked like he shuffled the feet and maybe got away with it. And this is Pendergraph working against Falker.
Arizona State has to be sure that they keep movement on the offensive end. Whenever Pendergraph gets it, you got to get some cuts so he's got some options to pass it to.
Top of the key, Abbott will try again. And I tell you what, it is just not Ty Abbott's days. He is now 1 of 7 from beyond the arc.
It's a great outside shooter. Shoots 36% on the year. I mean, those are good shots.
Shooters keep shooting.
Yeah, sometimes they just don't fall. You got to shoot your way out of it.
You know something about that.
Not enough.
There's another one from Bone, and that looked like it was down, but then out. And it'll be Arizona State basketball.
Josh Bone with the deep three. He shoots 34% on the year. And I think the story for a while, it was Southern Illinois. I talked about how they've got to hit some shots. They've got the great defense. Everybody knows what they're going to do defensively. It's a matter of who's going to make those shots. And Josh Bone is a guy. A few weeks ago back during their bracket busters, they thought if Bone can start to hit some outside shots, we can make a run. And then, of course, they lost that tough game to Illinois State that all but ended their NCAA hopes.
Bone was a big recruit for Chris Lowery. He was a runner-up Mr. Basketball in the state of Tennessee to a guy named Brandon Wright, who you may remember was one and done for North Carolina, as Southern Illinois will go to the free throw line. MasterCard NIT continuing Saturday on ESPN as the Akron Zips take on the Minutemen of Massachusetts in second round action. MasterCard NIT, second round, ESPN Saturday, noon Eastern time.
Well, we might see a goaltend on that last layup. Look to me like the Arizona State player. So he went up, didn't get the ball, but actually moved the backboard enough to alter it off the rim.
Green knocks down the first free throw. Tyrone Green, 75%er, gets them both, and we've got a two-point game.
It's been a low-scoring first half. Both teams in the mid-20s.
Which is exactly what you would expect from these two ball clubs.
Yeah, I think both teams got some good shots, just weren't making a lot of their open looks. Arizona State did a great job collapsing the defense and kicking it back out. And we talked about Ty Abbott, some of his struggles. He was one of the many that missed some open looks for Arizona State.
Southern Illinois averages less than 60 points a game. Arizona State just about 69 per. So these are not two teams that are going to burn up the floor with a game in the 80s. 10 on the shot clock now for Harden. Falker way out to guard him. Drive and dish. Kuksic gets the look, and he knew it as soon as it left the hand.
It's a mismatch. Poor Randall Falker's out there trying to guard at the three-point line. I mean, he might be able to guard some guys, but not James Harden. Pac-10 all-first-teamer, one of the best freshmen in the country. He's able to cross him over and find Kuksic in the corner.
Final 15 seconds of the half. Arizona State 28, Southern Illinois 23, and Josh Bone will play for the last shot. See if they screen and roll with Falker. Swing it to Shaw. He will beat the buzzer, draws iron, and that is how we leave things.
Not a bad first half. Both teams getting good looks, just not making their shots. And I think the question for the second half, how does Southern Illinois continue to play another 20 minutes with a short bench?
Well, we've got a competitive ball game here in the Valley of the Sun. Arizona State 28, Southern Illinois 23. Let's send it to the studio now. Kevin Negandhi and the Dick's Sporting Goods halftime report. Watching ESPN2's second round coverage of the MasterCard NIT in Tempe, Arizona, as the Arizona State Sun Devils host the Southern Illinois Salukis. Our score at the half, Arizona State 28, Southern Illinois 23. Scott Reese alongside Mike Kelly and the Sun Devils, Mike, led by James Harden on the offensive side of the ball and Jeff Pendergraph on the defensive side.
Well, Harden was great. 7 points, 6 rebounds, 5 assists. But I think it was Pendergraph that was the real difference maker. 7 blocks in that first half. That's one shy of a school record.
Arizona State will inbound to begin the second half. Up by 5 points, Derek Glasser, high school teammate of James Harden, will handle the ball.
I'll be curious to see how much Chris Lowery goes with zone in this second half. He tried it a bit, it didn't work. But with that short bench, I don't know how much man-to-man they can play, especially if they get into foul trouble.
Harden misses, gets his own rebound. Now the ball is loose and wrestled away underneath by Wesley Clements.
This is a Southern Illinois team known for their toughness. They're called Floorburn U. They will get after Arizona State. This is not a team that will wilt under pressure or in a tough environment on the road.
What do you do offensively if you're Southern Illinois to try and get some sort of flow?
I think you have to continue to try to get it inside, maybe to Falker. I don't like him when he gets the ball right there at the top of the key or at the free throw line. I don't think that's the best spot for him. When he gets it on the low block, he can work with his back to the basket. He's got a very quick spin move. Sometimes he can do the spin and go to the weak side, but when he has to face up from about 15 feet, that's not his forte.
Falker now just 2 of 12 from the floor. In fact, Falker and Matt Shaw combining right now for 3 of 21. And these are two guys that combine for more than 25 points a game. There's a jump shot from Pettigraph, won't go. And so far, lids on the hoops in the second half.
Well, we knew this wasn't going to be a high possession game. One of these games where the team will have to take advantage, maybe get in transition if they can.
Kind of like that off the Harden steal. Abbott will not shoot it. Remember, he had a miserable first half shooting the basketball, just 1 of 7 beyond the arc, so he gives it up. Here's Pettigraph, who will settle for the mid-range J, no good, and Kuksix corrals the rebound.
The last steal by Harden makes 71 on the year. That is just 6 shy of the school record for a freshman. Very unique to see Harden getting those passing lanes out of the zone. He's one of the great zone steal guys that I've ever seen.
Here's Green going to take it strong, lay it up and in. No good. Arizona State rebounds, and back the other way we go. Wild pass. Harden somehow able to bring it down, and the foul on Falker.
How about James Harden? He gets this ball. It almost looks like a trick play. This is almost an and-one play. He has to catch it over his head, and he almost dribbles it behind his back. Watch this. Can we call him Hot Sauce or something like that? The professor, maybe?
Can't teach that.
Maybe the professor. We're on campus, right?
James Harden now with 9 points to go along with 6 rebounds and 5 assists. And you mentioned the steals, and I think as good as he is offensively, Mike, the defensive side of his game is completely overlooked. He is tremendous on that end of the floor. In fact, he led the conference in steals.
If this makes any sense, he's not a great defender, but he makes great defensive plays at a high rate. They play this zone. It's hard to tell if a guy's a great defender when they're playing zone, but he gets in the passing lanes. He gets all those steals. And I mentioned how hard it is out of a zone to get a lot of steals. I think Jason Hart was probably the best I'd ever seen. Played for Syracuse. I played with him for a summer with the Milwaukee Bucks, and he was a great guy at getting in the lanes, even out of a zone.
And Jim Boeheim identified Jason Hart as maybe the hardest worker in his however many years at Syracuse.
Absolutely.
That's saying something. Arizona State still with possession. Up by 8, foul away from the ball, and they're going to get Matt Shaw as Pettigraph a little gimpy.
Well, it looked like him and Shaw just got tangled up on the low block. Their arms got tied up. You watch right down here. These are these guys playing. Not a whole lot there.
Looks like the knee twisted a little awkwardly. Pettigraph is okay. Stays on the floor.
Well, sometimes a savvy post player can create that contact on the offensive end. When he goes down, the ref is almost forced to call a foul. The ball's on that side of the court, and I think that's what happened here with Pettigraph. Nice job coaxing the official into making that call.
Once again, a foul away from the ball. This time, they're going to get, it looks like, Shaw once again.
That might be Clemens.
I think you're right. It is Clemens.
That's going to be 3 on him.
So Clemens earns himself a ticket back to the bench. Carlton Fay will replace him.
Yo, watch it! Yo!
Oh. Arizona State, maybe the best team in the country in out-of-bounds plays, scoring off of out-of-bounds plays. Herb Sendek, it's one of his specialties, drawing up great plays. They got about 50 of them. I don't even know how you can try and prepare for a team with 50 out-of-bounds plays. You just have to stick to your principles defensively.
And that time we're going to get an offensive foul on Arizona State. They may have gotten Pettigraph. His third foul is, yep, third foul on Pettigraph. That's something that bears watching because he's been a beast on the low block.
When he comes out, Boateng comes in, and they're not as proficient inside. They don't have that presence with Boateng. He's a very good player, but he's just not as good as Pendergraft. And allows the defense to focus more on Harden.
Josh Bone misses, and there's Pendergraft once again. And
ooh, they're going to get Pendergraft.
They're going to whistle him, and that is four.
Wow. That's a big foul. Pendergraft is a guy who's been getting into some foul trouble as of late. Sometimes some silly fouls, but try and watch the contact here. Boy, not a lot there. For a fourth foul, that's one that hurts. That's two guys just bodying up. You hate to see a kid as important to the game for Arizona State pick up his fourth in that manner.
So Pendergraft sits. In comes Jamaal McMillan, which means yet another freshman on the floor for this Arizona State team. Second half of this Pac-10 season, more than half the minutes combined for the Sun Devils went to first-year players. They're up eight. And defense now. This is Josh Bone who will pull up. And once again, he cannot connect. And another whistle all of a sudden. Again, a lot of fouls. They're going to get Kuksic. And the crowd does not like that call.
Well, we're seeing Southern Illinois. They were successful in the first half getting to the offensive glass. And now, while they're not getting rebounds, they're forcing Arizona State to get fouls.
Well, they do get the steal. And here's McMillan ahead of the pack. And he will lay it up softly.
He thought about it. See, that's what I did, too. I just go up, think about the dunk, and then lay it in. Nice play by McMillan there, converting on the other end.
By the way, I want to correct that last foul. Not on Kuksic. It was on Boateng, who has three fouls now. And Falker takes it right at him and scores.
That's where you get Randall Falker the ball. You don't put it to him on the high post or at the top of the key. You get it to him on the block. That's where he works best.
This is Abbott, who is fouled on the three, and it goes. Well, that's just a killer for Southern Illinois. One more look as Abbott just keeps on shooting. Didn't fall in the first half, but it's a new 20 minutes of basketball, and Arizona State leads by 11. Well, that young fella liking what he sees, and that is a great big Coke for one little man. Derek Glasser, by the way, now wearing jersey number 20. Don't be confused. That is still Derek Glasser, normally number 12, now number 20. He got some blood on the jersey. And a scoring change to tell you about, and it's a big one, as Jeff Pendergraft has three fouls, not four. So the situation not nearly as dire as we thought it might be for Arizona State.
At the same time, Boateng does have three fouls as well. So both of these guys in foul trouble. Of course, more important for Pendergraft to stay without getting his fourth foul than Boateng. But we'll see how long Boateng can give him a rest.
And we'll see if the Salukis try to pound it inside and get Boateng to pick up that fourth foul. Right now, they're out on the perimeter with Green and Bone, who will shoot it again. Not shy tonight, but then again, can't afford to be because somebody's got to put points on the board for the Salukis. Great pass from Harden to Boateng. And contact underneath. They're going to get a foul on Fay.
Well, we have seen James Harden with some of the most amazing passes. In that first half, I thought it was maybe too unselfish. And now we're seeing again in the second half. That time, catching the ball in midair and finding Boateng down low. That's just a great athletic play by the freshman.
And you see Pendergraft there staying warm on the sidelines.
I like it. That's an extra effort.
Loose ball, corralled by Abbott. Hey, look what I found and scored. Arizona State now up two touchdowns on the Salukis and looking for the knockout punch. Falker, double teamed. Oh, looked like a tie-up. That's certainly what Harden thought, but we're going to get a foul underneath.
I tell you what, this ASU defense right now, they look much better in the second half. They're playing more packed in. I thought in the first half they got stretched out a bit. In the second half, they're packed in. They're making Southern Illinois try and shoot from the outside, shoot over the top of them. And then when Falker gets it down low, they're collapsing very quick.
Falker good on the first free throw, which breaks an 11-2 Arizona State run. Kuksic's back into the game for Abbott. Randall Falker, the star of this Southern Illinois team, drops them both in. He now has 8 points, and the lead is 12.
And again, take a look at the 2-2-1 pressure. We saw some of this in the first half. I was a bit surprised. Just kind of token pressure, maybe trying to slow down Arizona State. I don't know if they're looking for a steal as much as they're just trying to slow down and maybe work some more clock for Arizona State.
The Sun Devils have had much better offensive rhythm to start the second half than they did to start the first half. McMillan will try a three, no good, but there's Jaren Schiff. A lot of second chances for ASU in this second half.
Yes, Southern Illinois back in a 2-3. That may have led to the offensive rebound when you can't put a body on somebody.
Tough to rebound out of that zone. Here's McMillan again, and if at first you don't succeed.
See, it's killer. When you're a man-to-man team, you have to play zone. First you give up the offensive rebound because you can't put a body on somebody, and then you're trying to play 2-3. Inevitably, you end up leaving a guy open, and that time, the second time around, they bury the outside shot.
Fay will take it inside. Bounce pass to Matt Shaw for the finish. That was pretty. But you got to get back in transition. Look at Harden find the open man. Ship for three. Out.
Now, Southern Illinois right now trying to string together some good offensive possessions. They've had a few flashes here and there. They're getting the ball to Falker inside. Last time to Shaw. But I haven't seen them put two or three or four possessions back-to-back together.
Salukis 18-14 on the year, trying to stay alive and reach the quarterfinals of the NIT, and Shaw underneath, and he has got to continue to put points on the board for this offensively challenged Southern Illinois club.
Well, it was a great job of getting position early. As you watch the replay, you'll see Shaw down low. Well, you can't see him there. He's out of the screen. But most of the time, a big guy has to do all his work before he gets the ball. If he waits till the guard is ready to pass it to him, it's too late. That time, Shaw doing a great job bodying out Kuksic down low so that when that ball gets there, there's plenty of room. Green's able to make that pass, and then Shaw can finish.
And in the process, Boateng picks up foul number 4. So he will sit. Pendergraf, who has 3 himself, is back in the game for Arizona State. Shaw at the line to complete the 3-point play, and the Salukis, for the moment, have stemmed the tide. They're back within 10. Once again, we see a little full court pressure. Arizona State able to put the ball across the timeline in timely fashion.
Well, one thing the 2-2-1 press allows Southern Illinois to do is fall back into the 2-3 much easier.
McMillan will take another one, and just when you think you've got the Sun Devils figured out, it's Jamaal McMillan who hits back-to-back threes.
Yeah, and from the same spot, the very top of the key. That's the spot against the 2-3 where one of the two guards, one of those two on the top of that zone, have to communicate and take him. That time, back-to-back possessions where they leave him alone and he makes him pay.
Outside shooters love that spot at the top of the key.
Outside shooters love zones, period. End of story.
A scrum for the Rock, and we are going to get a tie-up. Possession arrow favors Southern Illinois. Regional coverage of the NCAA Women's Basketball Championship tips off Saturday on ESPN2. You will see either Georgia Tech, Iowa State, or UT San Antonio, Texas A&M. NCAA Women's Basketball Championship presented on ESPN by Orbitz. ESPN2, Saturday, noon Eastern Time.
Always some good games on the women's side as well. Interesting article yesterday in USA Today talking about maybe playing the Final Four for the men and the women same site. Jay Billis saying play them on the same day even. Might be some logistics trouble there. I don't know.
Southern Illinois with the ball down by 13. They work it around to Fay, who will shoot the three, and that doesn't go. Had to beat the shot clock to get it off, and looks like McMillan stepped on the end line, so the Salukis get a break.
See, I love when Southern Illinois is moving without the ball and they're able to create for their teammates and try and get an assist. What I don't like is when I see guys trying to work off the dribble. This Arizona State defense is too good to try and beat them one-on-one.
Shaw can't get it to go. Another rebound for Pendergraf. Here's Kuksic ahead of the pack. Contact, no whistle. And Arizona State comes away with it. This is Abbott. And this time, Falker corrals the rebound. No numbers here as Green will pull it back out.
Yeah, fortunate for Southern Illinois. Arizona State unable to convert in the transition game. ASU's been good in the second half of trying to get out, push the pace a bit, get some easy baskets.
Bone is cut off, and really, you mentioned this a few minutes ago, the Salukis having a hard time getting any sort of a run together, even a 4-5-0 run, get some momentum and really get themselves back into this game. That's not going to help matters as Abbott has the rebound.
Bone's been very aggressive. I like it. He hasn't hit all of his shots. Not the best night offensively, but I like the aggressiveness in terms of looking for the shot.
Here's Pettigraph working on Fay, over Fay, and Falker with the rebound.
Good look by Pendergraf, and this is where Southern Illinois can make you pay for quick shots. They'll bring you back down and make you work on the defensive end. They sort of wear you down over the course of 40 minutes. At the end of the day, you start to miss your shots, and they start to make theirs.
Randall Falker working on a... He's got 8 points, 9 rebounds in the game, and there he's got the ball farther away from the basket than he would like to be.
Way too far.
Five on the shot clock. Green loses it. Here's McMillan ahead of the pack. Foul, and a good foul by Matt Shaw to prevent the easy bucket. And Arizona State going to the line, up by 13 with 10:42 to go in Tempe, Arizona.
SportsCenter right now, the Celtics complete the sweep of the Texas Triangle, beating the Mavs 94-90. Ray Allen hit a key three late in the fourth quarter. Boston is the first team to beat the Spurs, Rockets, and Mavs in one road trip in over 6 years. And the D'Angelo Hall trade between the Falcons and Raiders is now done after Hall agreed to a 7-year, $70 million contract with Oakland. Next SportsCenter, 2 a.m. Eastern. Stay current with ESPN News.
Kevin, thank you very much. The Raiders have some work to do. There's certainly a step in the right direction as they sign their shutdown corner. Scott Reese, Mike Kelly with you as we take you inside the play for Southern Illinois, Mike, and some post positioning.
Well, Scott, for a big guy, you got to work before you get the basketball. And Matt Shaw understands this. As you watch him work, here's the bottom of the zone. He's on the outside of Shaw, so Shaw's going to try and box him out here. So as the ball switches around, and they go to the top of the key, he's got the position down low to make that pass inside. And as a big guy, yes, when you get the ball, you want to make a move quick. But the more you work before you get the basketball, you put yourself in a better position to score once you do get it.
Jamaal McMillan now with 9 points off the bench. He has really given this Sun Devil team a spark. Can't hit the second free throw, but there's Pettigraph. Oh, and he loses it. Shaw with a nice play. Back on the salute. He's trying to cut into a 14-point deficit.
Now one of the problems, both of these teams want to play a low possession game, and a 14-point lead is like a 20-point lead most games.
Falker underneath, and that's where he wants the basketball. Southern Illinois needs a lot more of that.
Well, you see, he can face up, but when he faces up from 8 feet, it's a lot better than from 15 feet.
Oh, what a great pass from Harden. Pantograph is fouled underneath by Falker. I tell you what, first going up like a wide receiver just to bring that basketball down, and then in one fell swoop, he gets it to Pantograph underneath.
Well, there's certain things you can't really coach, and that's the athleticism to get that pass. That time, though, Harden, I mentioned before in the first half, as a lefty, he likes to get it on the right-hand side so he can drive into the lane using his left hand and his outside shoulder to get inside. And he can turn around, he can turn the corner and hit that shot. And even if he doesn't want to shoot, he's got the ability to get up in the air and find the open man, an open teammate. That's what makes him so dangerous. Yes, he averages 18 points, but he's also unselfish. He can find his teammates.
Derek Glasser returns, and in case you missed it earlier, wearing number 20 because he had some blood on his original jersey, which is number 12. So number 20 is Derek Glasser, the starting point guard for the Sun Devils, who incidentally has not scored yet in this game, but he hasn't had to, as Arizona State leads it by 13. Pettigraph trying to make it 14, and he does. I tell you what, Harden's teammates are going to have to start converting some of those great passes if he wants to get the first ever triple-double in Arizona State history.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right now, 10-6-6 on the night. Swing it to Clemens. Split the D, acrobatic shot, no good, back the other way, and this is Harden
Watch him take it strong and lefty finish. Can't stop it.
You really can't. You try to get back on defense, but he's so slippery when he gets that ball. He's a lefty, and I think it's hard for guys to match up in the transition game and stop him. He can put together a highlight reel of those transition buckets from the right-hand side and slash it into the left.
Falker trying to keep his team in it, gets the offensive board and swatted away. And if that was Pettigraph, that is block number 8. That ties an Arizona State school record and is one block shy of the NIT all-time record.
Wow, you gotta love it. Anytime a guy is gonna get that many blocks, he's gotta be very active and have great vision to be able to move side to side and get those blocks, because it's not always on his own man. Sometimes it's help side.
Fay for 3, no good. Bounces around, here is Shaw. And the Salukis with another chance. Bone, jump stop, and unfortunately, didn't stop long enough. Oh, no. I thought they were going to get a travel. Instead, they get a foul.
That was the highest jump stop I think I've ever seen attempted by Josh Bone.
Still not sure who they got the foul on. As long as it wasn't Pettigraph, who has 3, it was Glasser, so not a problem for Arizona State.
Watch Southern Illinois work from the outside. They got to find a way to penetrate, either off the dribble or get a pass inside of Falker.
Falker sets a screen here. Fay hasn't had the stroke from outside. Instead, he leaves it for Bone. Boy, that touched every part of the cylinder. Would not go down. Nice effort by Green, but Arizona State now with numbers if they want to run.
But even that little bit of penetration by Carlton Fay was enough to draw the defense and create an open look for Bone.
Off the turnover, a rare run-out opportunity for the Salukis. Crowd doesn't like that as they whistle Ty Abbott for the foul.
So quick, he stepped right in there. Yeah. I don't know if I've ever seen a tough play like that.
His second personal foul.
He kind of just ran in front. There wasn't a lot of contact on the play.
Take another look at it momentarily as Josh Bone goes to the line and hits the first.
Watch him, he just kind of slips in there as Bone is coming up. Catches him using the sideline as an extra defender.
That really couldn't have been any less of a foul. That was ball and actually a nice save too, but 1 out of 2 for Bone, and back the other way we go. It is 50-35 Sun Devils. Pettigraph over the double team, no go. Fay will clear.
I don't like that shot. That's a forced look early in the possession. This Arizona State team shooting the ball pretty well, getting some good shots whenever they want.
Especially when you're up by 15.
Yeah, I don't think they needed that one.
Here's Falker again. And score it for Randall Falker. 12 points, 11 rebounds now for the Saluki star.
And what we'll start to see is Southern Illinois extending their defense. Now, obviously, they play great defense, great ball pressure. But when you're down and you're under 8 minutes to go and your season's on the line, you've got to be extra aggressive on the perimeter and trying to force the action.
Winner of this game will take on either Florida or Creighton in the NIT quarterfinal.
This is a mismatch right here. They got to bring some help.
Shot clock winding down. Harden dishes. Glasser for 3. No go. So Derek Glasser still scoreless. This is Shaw. Thought about it. Harden defense. Southern Illinois can't afford to be quite so deliberate now as we head down toward the 7-minute mark in the ball game, and Pettigraph takes the charge from Shaw.
James Harden trying to get the first triple-double in Arizona State history. One of the ways he can do it off the break, get in transition, the silky smooth ability to get to the rim. Look shocked like you ain't know I was on top. I'm on business. This don't look back, look cool, cause you're not too.
Somebody's been reading the ESPN program log.
There you go.
NASCAR Now is, in fact, coming up next on ESPN2. Meanwhile, Mike, Jeff Pendergraft, not built for speed, but built for power.
Well, absolutely. Down low, he's been sensational, working against the defenders, sometimes help side, coming over to block the shot, sometimes against his own man when he's got the basketball. What has impressed me the most about Pendergraft is he's done all this without getting into big-time foul trouble. Yes, he's got 3 fouls. He had to sit a few minutes. We thought he had 4 for a second. That would have been bad news. But that 8 blocks tonight ties a school record. And for all our talk about maybe James Harden getting the triple-double, how about Pendergraft?
Yeah,
he's got 9 rebounds, 8 blocks, and 6 points.
That's a fair point.
He is definitely in territory.
A race for the first triple-double in Sun Devil history. By the way,
I want a double triple-double. That's what I'm looking for tonight.
All of a sudden, I got a hankering for in and out. Why is that? Arizona State with the ball. Under 7 minutes to go here in this second round NIT game. Pendergraft underneath, and they're going to get a foul on Green. You know, we mentioned that those 8 blocks, one shy of the NIT all-time single-game record, which is held by 5 players, including Ralph Sampson.
The legendary Ralph Sampson. It's good company to keep.
3rd foul on Green. By the way, Matt Shaw picked up his 4th just before we went to break. So now legitimate foul trouble for the Salukis, who are scratching and clawing, trying to stay in this thing. But again, without starter Bryan Mullins, backup Tony Boyle, it's an uphill battle from the start as the fouls continue to mount. Pendergraft knocks down the first. And that's an excellent point on the triple-double with blocks, because he's flirting, as we like to say. This will be 8 points if he converts. There it is, to go along with the 9 rebounds, 8 blocks.
You know, the scouting report on Pendergraft says sometimes he can be too emotional. He gets too wrapped up into the game, lets guys get under his skin, maybe pick up some silly fouls. He hasn't done that today. I've been impressed with his game. On top of all those blocks, he's been pretty poised throughout the 34 minutes that we played.
And it certainly helps when you get help from the officials. You know, early on, he was very aggressive on the defensive end. We saw a string of blocks in close sequence. If 2 of those become fouls instead of clean blocks, all of a sudden, maybe he's more tentative, maybe he starts to get emotional, and things go a different way.
Yeah, that's the life of a shot blocker. I mean, you're always worried about the whistle if they're going to call some quick fouls, but the refs let him play. I don't think there were a lot of missed calls in the mix with those 8 blocks. He was just very athletic, getting over, sliding over, help side defense to disrupt the offense for Southern Illinois.
Falker will hit 2 free throws. Nice game for him, 14 points, 12 rebounds. Jared Shipp gonna have to call a timeout. No, he gets it into Glasser, barely beating the 5-second count. And Harden will reset.
Arizona State is very good at playing with the lead. Not unlike Southern Illinois, they get that ball with the lead. They will run that Princeton-style offense and make you work defensively.
Nice play by Faye, but Pendergraft winds up with the basketball, and Harden gets it back to his high school teammate, Derek Glasser. And on the shot clock. Ball is deflected out of bounds and turned it over to Southern Illinois.
Great rotation out of Southern Illinois. That time, they jump the ball screen. Falker goes to trap. Anytime you trap 2-on-1, you're going to have a great weak side rotation. Towards the end of the shot clock, Southern Illinois doing a great job forcing the turnover.
Josh Bone for 3, and he cannot buy one. That is 2 that have hit just about every part of the cylinder. Haven't gone down, and Glasser will push. And the flush.
We've seen Arizona State try and get out in transition more in the second half. Harden has done it a few times. That time, Glasser pushing the rock, getting it to the big fella so he can finish.
Timeout, Chris Lowery. Southern Illinois on the verge of being blown out of the building. 54-39 is your score as Jeff Pendergraft and Arizona State getting it done in transition. The big fella will throw it down. Well, there's a pretty popular guy on this campus, huh?
There you go, Dennis Erickson.
football coach for Arizona State. Of course, did such a tremendous job with his Sun Devil group, leading them to a 10-3 record. Holiday Bowl berth.
Well, the football coaches last night, Urban Meyer and Bill Belichick, enjoying the Florida game.
Out of bounds off of Arizona State.
What if they're looking for a tight end out there, maybe? What do you think?
I'm not sure I see one on this ASU roster. I guess Boateng would be about as close as you get. Oh, I bet you Harden could play a little wide receiver. Speak of the devil. You see what I did there? The devil?
Yeah, I see. That's very good. Harden. He's got great vision. We talked about on the offensive end, finding the open man. That time defensively, though, he sees what's happening on the court. He can make that first step to get in front of that pass because he sees what's happening before the offensive player sees what's happening.
And Harden will change a game at both ends of the floor. And what they love about this kid is not only is he so talented, he is coachable. And here with the shot clock at 2, looks like Arizona State. No, they're not going to get bailed out. They will get the basketball, but 2 on the shot clock. Yeah, I'd give it to 13. Why not?
I was going to say, if anybody's got to play for 2 seconds left, sideline, out of bounds, it's Herb Sendick. But, of course, you have James Harden. You don't have to worry about a play. Just pass it in.
I tell you what, he's so meticulous about everything is Herb Sendick, and the attention to detail is sometimes mind-boggling, but his bread and butter is out of bounds place. I think he draws him up in his sleep.
I tell you what, Belmont fans right now wish they had another inbounds play chance.
Boy, how about that?
Almost had Duke today.
Almost had a rare 15-2 in round one of the NCAA tournament as Glasser is fouled. Pac-10 fared pretty well today in the NCAA tournament. We'll talk more about that on the flip side. Arizona State up 13 and going to the foul line when we come back. The Arizona State student body just hitting its stride at 10:45 at night on a Thursday. And, well, some of us are ready for a little nap.
It's March Madness. She'll learn. Give her time.
Give it time. MasterCard NIT continues on ESPN Saturday. The Akron Zips meet the UMass Minutemen. Second round action. ESPN Saturday, noon Eastern time. The winner of that game will take on Syracuse, the Orange beating Maryland in a 1-5 matchup earlier tonight. And, of course, the winner of our game gets either Creighton or the 2-time defending champs.
UMass played Syracuse this year and beat them earlier in the year, the non-conference schedule. UMass amassed a 22-10 record. Wins over Syracuse and Boston College.
Derek Glasser scores for the first time tonight. And for the second time tonight.
For Southern Illinois, Chris Lowery's trying to figure out a way where they can score some points. When they're down 15, this is an Arizona State team that doesn't give up that many points and under 4 minutes to play. I think they have to try and work the ball inside out first, get some good looks from Falker, and then maybe pass it out for the three.
Here is Shaw, sort of a leading shot around Harden. Can't get that to go, but another chance for the Salukis.
I'll tell you what, offensive rebounds doesn't hurt either. Multiple looks at it, trying to put the ball in the hoop.
Every little bit helps. Falker gives it up. This is Shaw. Nice move and scores over Pettigraf, so it's a 13-point game.
That's exactly what I'm talking about. Work it inside. Try and get a quick look. Now, though, on defense, you've got to force the action. You cannot just sit back and play a packed-in man-to-man defense. If you're going to play him straight up, try and force some turnovers.
Earlier, we saw Southern Illinois in a zone, and this was the first game, believe it or not, in the 4-year tenure of Chris Lowery at Southern Illinois that he employed a zone defense.
Yeah, I believe it. That's the philosophy that earns you the reputation as Florida and you. There you go.
Well, this time it's Glasser on the floor, but he traveled, so a turnover, and this is really the last gasp for Southern Illinois. Down by 13, enough time to make a quick run, but problem for this Saluki team is they don't do much of anything quickly.
Well, give credit to Falker again. He's done a great job today of jumping out and trapping the ball screens. He does it there, and they force the travel.
Outside shooting, not their forte. They pound it inside to Falker. This time he is fouled, and they're going to get Harden on the half.
He took a shot.
Yes, he did.
But that's absolutely the play I'm talking about. Getting it inside to Falker. The possession before that, he got the ball about the high post and dumped it low to Shaw. This time he works with the ball himself. Bone doing a great job faking a pass and then making a pass. And the way Falker is able to split the double team to go up with it and then get to the free throw line, very impressive. A lot expected out of Randall Falker this year. He's had a good year. The team as a whole probably didn't produce the way they wanted to, but expectations were so high after losing the MVC player of the year last year, Jamaal Tatum, and Tony Young, another great guard. Those two guys led them to the Sweet 16 in a great game against Kansas, a game they almost won.
Salukis were ranked early on in the season as a foul is called. And you talk about the expectations, and why not? After six straight NCAA appearances, this team is expected to dominate the Missouri Valley Conference. Fair or not, that is the level to which Chris Lowery has elevated this program.
Absolutely. They've turned themselves into the Butler of the Horizon League or the Gonzaga of the West Coast Conference.
Randall Falker now with four fouls. Pettigraph goes back to the line. 11 points, 9 rebounds, and 8 blocks for the junior, who, by the way, like James Harden, has already announced that he will come back to Arizona State next season. And I tell you what, if in fact both of those players follow through on their promises, this is going to be one heck of a team next year.
Well, it's a great team this year, and the youth movement has served its purpose. They've learned, they've taken some lumps on the road. I think they'll probably schedule a much better non-conference schedule next year. And this is a team that will be playing in NCAAs next year.
There is Shaw, which that didn't come close. Ship rebounds, and Arizona State now in control, under 2 minutes to play in Tempe.
And while Glasser maybe hasn't scored a lot today, he certainly is a guy that you want on the court when you're trying to run out the clock. A great ball hammer, a traditional point guard. He knows how to take care of it.
A calming, steady influence as he runs the show. And the fans here at Wells Fargo Arena, well, they can smell and taste the blood in the water as James Harden works on Shaw. This is Glasser for three, and we'll call that a dagger.
Well, we just mentioned how great Glasser is, handling the rock. A great free throw shooter, struggled for the field today. And his biggest shot coming at the end, that was absolutely a dagger.
Southern Illinois answers as Bowen finally tickles the twine. He's gotten a whole lot of rim, it seems like, with every three-point shot. That one does fall, and it's a 13-point game. Timeout, Chris Lowery. Regional coverage of the NCAA Women's Basketball Championship continues Saturday on ESPN2. You'll see Auburn, George Washington, Fresno State, Baylor, Hartford, Syracuse, or Robert Morris, Rutgers. First round action of the NCAA Women's Basketball Championship presented on ESPN by Orbitz. ESPN2 Saturday at 2 Eastern Time. Scott Reese, Mike Kelly with you from Wells Fargo Arena in Tempe, where Arizona State representing the Pac-10. And I tell you what, the conference had a very eventful day, most of it coming in the NCAA tournament, where we saw wins by UCLA, Stanford, Washington State, losses by Southern Cal and Arizona. And I know that there are some Sun Devil fans sitting at home saying, you know what, gee, we could have lost by 10 in the first round of the tournament too. Yet here we are.
I think UCLA is going to get credit for more than one victory.
Yeah.
What did they win by, like 50?
Yeah.
They're up 70-29, I think, at one point.
I'm still trying to figure out how Washington State won by, 31 after being tied at the half?
Listen, that's all about Tony Bennett right there. That's my guy.
Foul is on Green. That's his fourth, and it'll send Harden back to the line.
They win by 31. I don't know how many times they've actually even scored 31 points in the second half of a game.
I mean, for anybody to outscore a team by 31 and a half is fairly astounding. Never mind
but
that it's Washington State.
Yeah. Well, Winthrop struggle. That's a great Winthrop team. I got a chance to do the Big South semifinal and final. They beat Kenny George and UNC Asheville. I think a lot of people know Kenny George, big 7'7". 365 pounds, size 27 shoe. never had a driver's license because most cars he can't fit in, and even if he can't fit in, he can't work the pedals. His feet are so big.
Here is Bone again. No go. Pettigrew almost had the rebound, and, well, I don't think they're going to give him credit for that, which is a shame because it would have been a double-double.
Yup, they do.
They give Pettigrew credit for the rebound, so officially a double-double for Jeff Pettigrew. Now the drama is, can he block two more shots in the last 45 seconds?
It's a home game. They'll give him that rebound. At least give him a double-double.
And the foul on Harden. So Arizona State will move on to the quarterfinals of the MasterCard NIT and will await the winner of Creighton and Florida. And how nice would it be for the Sun Devil faithful to get a look at the two-time defending champions here at Wells Fargo Arena?
Absolutely. And Billy Donovan playing at Providence while Herb Sendek spent some time there on the staff. And then they coached together at Kentucky.
Harden is true on the first free throw, and, well, now it's really official. Once we put him in, they're in.
That's it. We can't take him out?
Can't take him out. A couple of one seeds advancing to the quarterfinals, and, of course, the goal here is to win one more game, get yourself to Madison Square Garden, play in the world's most famous arena on the national stage, and, hey, you know what? You win the NIT, it's a national championship.
Absolutely. I think that's the beauty of the NIT is, yes, you know, their teams, some teams disappointed to be there. But after that first round, it's a very difficult first round. You get past that into these second and third round games. That's when teams are starting to figure out, hey, yes, maybe we didn't get to the ultimate, what we really wanted. But you know what? We can win a national championship. We can get to New York, play in the Madison Square Garden. It's still a great event because of that. And that's why you see teams, I think, maybe some letdowns in the first round, but once you get past that, everything is all good. And these teams are absolutely trying to get a national championship.
And let's not forget, this Arizona State team was 2-16 in the Pac-10 a year ago as Jeff Pettigrew gets a well-deserved round of applause from the Sun Devil faithful. 2-16 in the pack a year ago, 8-22 overall. Herb Sendek turns it around with the infusion of freshman talent, 9-9 in the conference, just a hair shy of the NCAA tournament. But I have to think, Mike, that, you know, you talk about some teams in their situation might have not had their collective head in the game playing in the NIT instead of the NCAA. But when you consider where they came from and how quickly they turned this thing around, you know they're moving in the right direction, and they are happy to be here.
Yeah, it starts with the coach. When you read the quotes from Herb Sendek after they found out they weren't going to get into the tournament, when he took some time, he talked to his team, they reflected on it, said, guys, let's not point fingers. We had games we should have won and could have won that wouldn't have left it in the selection committee's hands. Instead, we didn't. So now what we do, we focus on the NIT. Let's go out and try and play our best. And he's done a great job of getting this team focused.
This one has reached its conclusion. Arizona State 65, the Salukis of Southern Illinois 51. Once again, the Sun Devils move on to play the winner of Creighton and Florida. You can see that game Friday night at 9:30 Eastern time on ESPNU. Akron and UMass will battle it out on ESPN2 Saturday for the right to play Syracuse. All smiles for James Harden and Arizona State as they beat Southern Illinois 65-51. Coming up next, NASCAR now presented by Shell. The proceeding has been an exclusive presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Mike Kelly and our entire ESPN2 crew, I'm Scott Reese. Good night from Tempe, Arizona.